There's not one day that doesn't pass in this church that we don't pray. Not one day. From Sunday to Sunday, we have prayer meetings in this church. Why am I saying that? I'm only saying this for one reason. Because we believe in the power of prayer. We believe that God wants to do something very special, and nothing happens unless God's people pray. Amen. We might have a few folk praying during the week, but like I said to you, where two or three are gathered in the name of Jesus, if we believe in the name of Jesus, if we truly believe, we are going to see some powerful things happening. But you must believe. Do you think Christianity is just a nice cultural religion where we just go to church? Do you think really that that's how the church was born? Do you think the disciples, when they first came to Christ, they went to their house services and they went home and had a really wonderful lunch and that was it? Their lives were at stake. They had a burden. They saw their friends killed, tortured for Christ. There was conviction to serve Jesus meant life or death. They weren't serving God because it was in vogue, or it was cool, or it's what's to do. It's to be accepted by my society, my culture. It's nice on my resume that I go to church, so let me put it in my resume. Well, excuse me? Is that why we serve God? So we can look good? Oh my God. Listen, folks, we have to understand that you are saved. You are a believer for a reason. And I promise you this, you're not a believer just to come to Logos, warm up the pew, and go home. Because if that's why you're a believer, I'm packing up my bags and I'm going home. Because that's not what it's about. I'm not here, or anybody else shouldn't be here, just so we can have a nice church service. It's not about having a nice church service. Jesus didn't die so you and I can have a nice church service. Now, some of you might be upset in what I'm saying. And some of you might be here for the first time and I say, hello, visitors. Kind of strange that you're here for that doesn't always happen like this, but here we are. I want to welcome you all. But I just want to speak from my heart this morning. There's got to be more in serving God than what we have today. This can't be all there is. It can't be. There's got to be more. If my walk with God is just about coming to church once a week and going home, then I've missed it somewhere. My Bible isn't telling me something's wrong. I don't understand the Bible then. Because my Bible tells me that there's power in the name of Jesus. My Bible tells me that there's a joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. My Bible tells me there's a peace that passes all understanding. My Bible tells me you will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. My Bible tells me that you will speak with new tongues. My Bible tells me that when you experience the power of God, it will change your life. I don't know if I see that much today. Can I be honest with you? You say, Pastor, well, you're negative. Oh, I get that. You're just a negative. I'm not negative. I'm speaking the truth. Listen, statistically, the churches are dying today. Did you know that? Can I be honest with you? Well, there's a few churches, I thank God, that are... Overall, we're not doing very well, folks. I know that because I got the latest statistic from my general superintendent. Some churches are closing down. Some churches are closed. No one church should ever close down. But when the fire goes, of course it's going to close down. When the fire goes, then what do we have? Just religiosity. That's all we have. If the fire goes. Evan Roberts, one of the greatest men of God that ever lived in 1905, the greatest revival historically of all times took place in Wales that spread across the world. More churches, more people got saved and came to Christ during this revival than any other revival, even greater than 1906. Evan Roberts was mightily, mightily used of God. It started when he was 13 years old. He would pray for revival. 13 years of age. What does a 13-year-old kid know about revival? Let me tell you something. When God gets a hold of your heart, you'll know what revival is. And he started praying when he, not until he was 26 years old that he saw revival spread like fire throughout the land in a small country called Wales. Two years ago, a pastor wanted to go back to Wales where this revival took place. It's a true story. And so he went to this remote area in Wales. I forget the name of the place, the town. He took a cab there, and he asked the cab driver, he says, can you please take me to where Evan Roberts used to live or where revival used to break out? He says, well, what? Where revival broke out, Evan Roberts, he said, didn't even know who he was. And then he found out from somebody who was probably in this area. So he went knocking on doors. He says, excuse me, I'm Pastor so-and-so from the States. I just want to visit where Evan Roberts used to live and just where he prayed. And I'm doing some historical research. And I just want to see, you know, the churches. He says, well, you probably go down the road. There might be somebody that knew him. And he knocked at this farmer's house and says, hi. He says, my name is so-and-so. I'm looking for where Evan Roberts used to live. The revivalist, he says, oh, you're in the right place. I'm his grandson. He says, you're his grandson? He says, yeah. And he gave him Evan Roberts' Bible. He showed him Evan Roberts' Bible, and in big black bold letters in the front of the Bible, it was written, Lord, may I always yield to the Spirit of God. May I always yield to this. In other words, may I always surrender my life to what God is saying and what God's doing. And he said, well, can you show me the churches, please, where Evan Roberts preached and where they are today? He says, I will take you, but you will be discouraged. He takes the, this is a true story, he takes the pastor and he brings them to these churches. Each one of them were closed and barred down by wood. They're all gone. They're all, no vacancy. Sorry, no occupancy. Every church is barred in that area. The pastor says, wait a minute. How can this be? How can this be that these churches that experience so much, how can they be closed? He said, sir, that's what happens when man interferes with the Spirit of God. They became religious, see. So they wanted to take the Spirit of God and mold it to what they want. So we will only do this once and twice we might do this, and we'll do this over here, we'll go here. And everything was so calculated that the Spirit of God could not move anymore. Why do you think in the book of Ephesians the Bible says, do not quench the Spirit of God? You know, we can quench the Spirit of God by what we want to do. Do you know we can quench the Spirit of God just by the attitude we have by coming to church? Do you know when we come to church, we should be ready to receive from God? Do you know that we can quench the Spirit if we have had any kind of fleshly activity, anger, bitterness, aught? Do you know that if you don't make it right and you come and worship the Lord, that the Spirit could be quenched because your heart isn't right? You say, Pastor, that's what Jesus said. Did he not say before we worship, you come to the altar, put, if you have aught against your brother, put that gift at the altar, just put it there. Don't even begin to worship unless you make it right. Yes. You see, when revival comes, what's going to happen is that conviction will begin to rise up again. When the Spirit of God begins to move, there's going to be a sense of his holy, awesome presence. There's something's going to stir within your heart. It's not going to be just a mechanical service anymore. It's going to be like you're actually in the very presence of God, where God will speak to you and your hearts begin to melt in his presence. Now you know why I talked about prayer. That's what we are praying for every single day in this church. Brothers and sisters, that's my vision. That's what I believe God wants to do. A lot of people have left us. When I started here, they left. No, they didn't like what was being said, for the most part. We don't know if we want to sign up for this, Pastor. We just want to have a nice, comfortable service, and then let's go home so I can have a nice, comfortable lunch. But folks, if that's how you feel, I love you so much, but you won't be happy here. Pastor, are you telling us to leave? No. I don't think I am. Maybe I am. I'm not sure. But no, I'm having fun. But my point is, it's not going to happen. Because we are praying for revival. You can't pray for revival and want to live a life of mediocrity. It will not work. You will never be comfortable here. I love you to pieces. God knows that. But I just want God to move. I'm tired of just the normal religious activity we go through week after week. I'm tired of that. There's got to be more than this. Got to be more. A few Wednesdays ago, I wanted to teach on the book of Ruth so we can prepare us for David, and I did that. As I was studying the book of Ruth, preparing for David, that I was supposed to preach today, the Lord spoke to me when I was in chapter 1, my first message, and I've shared this before, and I'm going to share it again, because I believe it's paramount and very important to what I need to say. What had happened to Israel, that they were in sin. And the Bible says, because they sinned against the Lord sent a famine. Sometimes the Lord will send a famine in the land because of sin. That's in the Bible. You can research it yourself. So in some respects, a famine is a sign of sin. And Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, took his children to Moab, a place that God told him not to go. Elimelech did not pray. We see no record of him praying or seeking God. He just took his children and his family, and he went to Moab, seeking life, seeking bread. When he went to Moab, unfortunately, the very antithesis happened. He died, and his two children died. The paradox is, he went to find life, and he found death. You will always find death when you leave the place that God wants you to be. And then after 10 years, Naomi, the wife of Elimelech, she now has two daughter-in-laws because they married her two sons who died, has a yearning to go back to Bethlehem, which is the house of bread. That's what Bethlehem means. There was no bread in the house of bread. Isn't that a travesty? And I started musing over, no bread. I said, Lord, could this be what's happening in the church today? Bethlehem means the house of bread. Is it possible, Lord, that in your house there's no bread? Is it possible that what we have in your house is more entertainment and more extravagance than real bread? Is it possible? Bread meaning the word of God. Chuck Swindoll said that today there's very little exegetical preaching anymore. It's out of vogue. We don't want too much preaching anymore. Just give us some entertainment, a few thoughts, a few games, and let us go home happy. That's not the church. There was no bread in the house of bread. But here's my very important verse. I believe it's verse 6 of chapter 1. And the Bible says, and the people heard that the Lord had visited his people with bread. And people came. Here it is. Then she rose with her daughters-in-law, and she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Where did she hear this? When she was in Moab. Now watch. Leave it there, please. Now, you know what revival is? When God does something so powerful in a place that people in Moab are going to hear about it, and they're going to start coming to be fed. Because you know what the truth is, friends? Everybody's really looking for bread. They just don't know it. Everybody is looking for true bread. And they're going to Moab to find it, but they don't find it. You'll never find true bread in Moab. Only in God's house. And she came. Because God had visited his people. Which tells me that for the last 10 years, God did not visit. So there was still a house in Bethlehem. There was still a house of bread in Bethlehem, but there's no bread. There are still churches everywhere, but there's no bread. Unless God visits his people again. That's what revival says. And didn't Jesus say in the last days men's hearts would be getting colder and colder? Didn't he say that? Didn't it say in Amos that there's going to be a famine in the land, but not of wine or oil, but of the word of God? Everything is coming together, my friends. Today, Christianity is more under attack than ever before. There is more deception today than ever before. And somebody's got to rise up and smell the roses. We got to realize that we're in a battle. And we got to believe and take a stand for what you believe. And that's what we're doing here. That's what I want to do. I know I'm not going to be, you know, loved by everybody. I don't care about that. I mean, I want to be liked. Of course I do. Everybody does. But that's not what, I don't care. That's not the issue for me. Because I know I'm going to have a lot of enemies too. Because this is not a popular message, folks. Not everybody's going to like it. But if you're hungry for God, you'll be here. If you're thirsty for God, you'll be here because you'll get your bread. You'll get your water. It will come. You believe it because it's coming. Josh, can you come to? There must be more than this stirred up in our hearts. I want to thank you for being patient with me. I know this is certainly not common procedures. And for our visitors, we do love you. This is not what happens every Sunday, but maybe it should happen every Sunday. I don't know. But I just want God to move. I've been in ministry since 1984. Became a Christian in 1980. Went to Bible college for 3 years. Graduated in 84. I've never stopped praying for revival. I saw glimmers of it every so often, certain places where God's presence was so rich, people got healed. Little children falling down under the power of God. People's lives being touched, marriages restored. I've seen healings before my eyes when God pours out his. I've seen cancers healed in revival. When God's presence is so rich, things happen. You can't be the same when God's presence is in the house. That's why we're praying for revival. Can you join with me? Because it's not about a movement, it's about God. What he wants to do. It starts with you and me praying together, believing want to encourage you to come and pray with us. We have daily prayer meetings here every day for revival. Twice on Friday and Sunday morning before church service. We pray the same thing every single day. One day, my friend, it's going to come. If I send my messenger to prepare the way, and those that seek the Lord shall suddenly come to his people. Suddenly. Because God's got a lot more to give if you just have hearts open to receive. Can we all stand together, please? Bring the praise team to come forward. A prayer this morning.
There must be more than this. Spirit of God, we wait for you. Fill us anew.
To stir it up, we're not talking about our emotions. The Bible tells us in the book of Haggai, the first chapter, that the Lord stirred the heart of Zerubbabel to build the temple. The Lord stirred the heart of the priest, Joshua. The Lord stirred the hearts of the people to build. That's the Spirit of God stirring, causing, shifting. It's the Spirit of God. This is not emotions. This is His Spirit gripping us. That's what we're praying for. If you want God to stir your heart, I'm not going to ask you to come forward. If you want that, listen, if you want revival, if you want to make a difference in this world, if you want more than what you have in your walk with God, it's going to take a commitment. I tell you, friend, you've got to be dissatisfied with the things of this world, dissatisfied. You just can't tolerate things anymore. When you tolerate things, you might as well say, I accept it, but I'm not going to accept it anymore. I got to stand. There's got to be more than this. Got to. This is not how the church started, my friend. We need to get back to our first love. If that's you, I'm not calling you forward, but I'm going to ask you to pray with me. And then I'm going to challenge you to really do something about it. Pray intensely about it. Every revival was born through prayer. Prayer is the womb of the Spirit. Prayer is the womb of what gives birth spiritually. When you pray passionately, you're giving birth to spiritual things. Prayer becomes a womb, a place of incubation. And all of a sudden, that birthing takes place. And the reality of your prayers take place within the womb of the Spirit. That's what true prayer is. See, prayer, sometimes the answers don't come overnight because there's a 9-month gestation period in the spirit realm. I don't know how long that might be. But you got to keep praying. Keep interceding. And one day, suddenly, something's going to happen. I'm asking you to believe that with me. If you want to see your life and the church and Logos, and it's not about Logos, just the church rise up to make a difference in this world again. It's going to take people like you and me with conviction, wholehearted conviction, to take a stand for righteousness and truth. And that means your life will be changing. Can't pray for revival and sing and dance with the Philistines at the same time. Doesn't work that way. You can't pray out of Bethlehem and live in Moab at the same time. Can't do it. Can't do it. It's going to take sacrifice, commitment. But I'll tell you something. When God does it, oh my God. There are no words. When I saw revival in Bible college in 1982, 83, I can still smell the aroma of that time. So powerful. I saw people confessing sins they did 10 years ago, bringing it back. I've seen people weeping, men, grown men weep like little children. You've never seen any emotion in their hearts. I've seen the power of God. We couldn't sleep for days. I went to try to go to bed around 1 o'clock. I couldn't. We would pray 24 hours straight. So powerful was the Spirit of God, you couldn't go home. So thick was His presence, it was like heaven on earth. You couldn't go home. I was there. I was in the midst of it. I saw it, part of it. For 10 days, our classes were canceled. Lives were changed. I saw glimpses of it when I was at Howard Park in 1994 to 96. We saw the prayer meeting so filled we couldn't fill the room anymore. Bruno, 100 people were in that prayer room. I don't know if you remember that. Where's Bruno? Tony, you remember it. Mark, do you remember that prayer meetings? Remember that, Mark? Over 100 people came to pray. We had no room. They were standing. They were so hungry for prayer. They were standing up like you are in a small room for prayer. 100 people to pray. And we didn't pray 2 minutes. Start at 7, we didn't get out of there till 1 o'clock in the morning. Some people were so filled with God's presence, they couldn't move. had to carry them, put them into the car. You might say, what kind of crazy? No. Sometimes God is so powerful, he overwhelms you, you can't move. If you don't believe me, read Chronicles chapter 5. You'll see a story that happened to Solomon, where the power of God was so rich, they couldn't move. All they can do is fall down and worship the Lord. That's all they can do. I've seen it. I've been part of it. I don't speak out of the emotions of my heart. I speak what I've seen and experienced and what I see in the Word of God. And it can happen again through your life and my life. Father, bless this church now. May these words go deep into our hearts today, Lord. May they not go to the wayside where the birds eat the seeds and devour. May this word go deep into our hearts today. May it resonate. May fruit be born, I pray. May we see a mighty revival one day, Lord. May we see people healed and saved. May we see your glory in our midst, your power. May we see your name exalted. May you be free to move as you will, Lord, like you did in days of old. May there be liberty to worship you in the house of God, freedom to praise you. May we not be restrained by any kind of things or obstacles. May you break those chains, O Lord. May you visit your house with bread again, Lord. For my house shall be called a house of prayer, a house of bread. May you fill this house with your bread, Lord, for your glory. Revive thy works again that thy people may rejoice, O Lord.
Jesus.
In Jesus' name. We love you so much. You dismissed to go, but if you want to stay a little longer to worship the Lord, Josh, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. If you want to just continue to worship with us, please feel free. If you must go, God bless you. Have a wonderful afternoon. And we'll see you again very, very soon.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes. Together.
My shame is love.